Tom Wesselman was an American pop artist. He grew up actually in Cincinnati, Ohio. That's where he was born. Then after I went to study in New York, he was one of the founders of the pop art movement in the 60s. Then he tried to dissociate himself from the pop art group, but it was already labeled as a pop artist. And he passed away in 2004.
Why Tom Wesselman?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Well, an obvious answer would be he's a great artist, but there's more an institutional reason is that, or an art historical reason is that there has never been a retrospective in North America. And so when the idea, the opportunity to look at his work from an art historical retrospective point of view came up, where we said, this needs to be done. This is a great, great opportunity.
Mr. and Mrs. Bellefeuille saw the exhibition of Tom Wesselman at Hunch and Venison 2 or 3 years ago, I can't remember exactly, in London. And they were impressed by the work. I said, why don't we do that in Montreal, right? And then when we knew about the show at the museum, we entered in contact with the agents and representative of the estates, of the estate of Tom Wesselman, and then we said, let's do an exhibition, and they agreed.
The idea came from a friend who's in New York, who works for as a dealer, basically, and he says, are you interested in doing that? And Emilio Steinberger, his name is, and it's a great fellow, and we just hooked on very quickly, and our director went to see the estate, the studio, see the works. And when you see these works, you understand that the amazing impact. And when you look at the overall production, you say what a great artist from start to finish. But Wesselman, and so we worked closely with the estate, because Wesselman always knew there would be retrospective someday. He was disappointed he'd never have one in New York. Very disappointed in that. But knowing that there at one his time would come, he kept the great works. ¶¶
We knew they were doing an exhibition. We said, let's do an exhibition of Wesselmann at the same time. We asked to have original works, but the estate said, well, the museum having the show with original works will give you the prints. So we're quite happy with that.
And so it's interesting to look at Wesselmann now rather than, you know, 20 years ago, because we see the great artist that he was. He's a man who's totally involved in art history, in the knowledge of art history, in trying to redefine art history. We see, you know, dedicated studio artists. We see formalists, you know, working on big scale with billboards and publicity material, but really working out compositions. And we see artists who are very knowledgeable of art history. There was a show 2 years ago of Lichtenstein, Reflections on Art, that went to Cologne. And with works such as these, where you see Wesselmann play with Mondrian, both by quoting him and by composing the picture like a Mondrian, you realize that those pop artists weren't so much obsessed with, you know, consumer culture than with just, you know, making grand scale compositions with material and with new material. The way we shaped it is that we worked a lot on that. The problem with an artist who is so systematic, so methodical, and so logical like Wesselmann, is that you can't escape from the lines he's defined. He's just totally, you know, logical. You can't break his art apart in thematic groups. And and then there are all these series that run parallel, you know, the mouths, the smokers, the bedrooms, the nudes. And you see, God, one starts in there. There are seven series that start in 1964, and they run up to 85. And how do you put all this together? And so we said we have to follow the main concerns that he was dealing with as an artist. But we have to break his work down in chronological order, but following these formal issues. and we defined four major issues. The first years he's concerned with genre, nude, still life, landscape. He's redefining genre, still life, interior. Mm-hmm. The second issue, he goes into concerns over form, focus, aggrandizing, you know, a scale. And he's all, you know, obsessed with that. And so that leads us from like 65 to 80. And those are the bedrooms, the mouth, you know, the Volkswagen. It starts with the still lives, you know, like this huge 7-Up, but leads into the other series. And then with the steel drawings, he becomes totally obsessed with line, issues of lines, and drawings, and doodles, and sketching. And it's all throughout his life. But it takes on a new, form with the steel drawings that he's an inventor of. And so then we move through all his steel drawings and his working with lines. Then at the end of his life, he accidentally returns to abstraction and still does figuration. And then what comes out is his obsession with compositional structure. It's all throughout his life, but at the end, that's really sort of brings all the work together. So, and he reconciles, you know, figuration and abstraction. So, you know, that's like the overarching formal structure. And then we work the chronology within that. And it made sense. And the people from the estate said, it's just the most fluid narrative we've ever seen. It's just like, it's fluid, it flows.
Yes.
And you don't know this like form and scale. It's not written, you know, it's in neon letters, but it structures the show. And then going through the chronology sort of makes it flow naturally. And and then it allows for surprises also, because you're changing, you know, chapters. Mm-hmm. You know, you're there, still lives, and then God, the objects are striking, and then oh, what are these lines? And that's, I think, it's in that sense, I'll give ourselves all the credit we deserve.
Yeah.
It's really well done.
Yes.
Wesselmann's great intuition is to have understood in 59 that you couldn't go further in abstract painting. He wanted to be de Kooning, you know, so admirative of de Kooning, said. But then he figured, well, I can't be de Kooning because de Kooning is de Kooning, so I have to find my own voice. And he said, well, we can't go any further in abstract painting, so let's just start, you know, figurative painting anew. Mm-hmm. Let's you know, scrap everything and take it from the beginning once again. And so he says, what is figurative painting? Traditional figurative painting, genres, so, you know, nudes, landscapes, still lives, and that's what he goes about doing. But he does this with such a sense of visual impact. And with the knowledge or the consciousness that he was living in, you know, post-war 1960 America and not in Paris in 1920. But he's really looking at Matisse and Picasso and the great moderns and saying, we're going to revive that tradition. And that's what he does. So, in a sense, Lichtenstein comes to the same conclusion from different perspectives, says, you know, we can't go any further in abstract art. Figurative painting, it's all been done. So let's start painting art history again, but from a, you know, cartoon Band-Aid art style perspective. Okay. Thank you.
Why do you think it's that he didn't have any, hasn't had any retrospective in the States?
A lot of reasons for that, because Westerman's been like highly acclaimed in Asia and in Europe. There have been many retrospectives. I mean, people there know the value of this amazing artist. In the States, maybe his reputation as a painter of nudes sort of bogged him down in maybe in the 80s and 90s, you know, but after the Mapplethorpe scandal in Cincinnati in 89, a lot of museums turned chilly towards any controversial matter. So that's one reason. He was offered a retrospective at the Guggenheim in 94. There were talks with Thomas Krentz then, but that Wesselman said no, because he considered that the galleries were not appropriate for his art, and I think he was right. You know? It's killer space, yes. The Guggenheim, for such works. So, I guess just a mixture of missed opportunities and reputation that lingered, that he was a painter of nudes, and where it's just so much more than that. So every time I would mention that to a colleague in an American museum, seeking out loans and discussing the topic, I'd say, oh, there's never been a retrospective of his work yet in North America. And they'd say, what? That was the obvious reaction. Always, what? They just couldn't understand it. They were sure that, you know, this major artist had been celebrated, you know, numerous times. Westerman was also the problem, what he suffered from was not being as known as Castelli and as Warhol and Lichtenstein. And Warhol is like a persona. You may not know his work, you know his face, yes. You know Warhol. It's like the most photographed artist of the century with Picasso. And Lichtenstein, you know his style. You may not know his production, you may not know every chapter of his work, but you can, spotted Lichtenstein on the museum wall anytime. And Westerman was not a charismatic figure. He was a very discreet guy, family man, studio artist, and didn't hang around parties, didn't even go to his own openings, in Europe and Asia. Just didn't like traveling. And he didn't have a recognizable style because he was always reinventing his art and his approach to art. But when you go through his career, you're impressed that, the basis is always his, but his capacity to generate new ideas is very striking. And that came from him always being in the studio, always looking at what he had done, trying to figure out, creating problems in order to, figure them out. Yes. And it's a way of working that's very strong. Westerman would figure out the scale for each of his works. There was no predetermined scale for any market niche. So that's interesting to see him work with scale. It's an amazing boldness and sense of visual impact too, I think is inspiring. Wesselmann's a very classic artist. Mm-hmm. And the 60s and 70s and 80s were not good periods for, in the 90s, and less so for classic artists, mm-hmm. you know, who go for the genres, the nudes, the landscape, who just were, try to nail that composition perfectly. It was so, you know, retrograde and bizarre to do that, mm-hmm. you know, from a 90s perspective. So I guess Wesselmann suffered from being, you know, out of sync, both with the market and with his time. But now we look at him and say, God, what a fascinating artist.
Did he sell?
He sold a lot. Okay. I mean, that's Albright Knox, mm-hmm. that's Kimiko Powers, that's Mograbi collection, that's Weissman in Los Angeles. MoMA has lent us mm-hmm. a couple of pieces, Philadelphia. Virginia has some, they're not in the show here. The Robert B. Mayer collection in Chicago. Hirshhorn mm-hmm. Lent us three works. So the major museum, LA Mocha, major mm-hmm. museums, you know, collected him, but you're right. There are some works like this one, or this amazing, you know, monochrome still life with a clock and a lamp and a fan that are functioning. Yeah. I mean, these are amazing works from 1962, mm-hmm. and if you had to see one in the museum, they're knockouts. Yeah. There are great works so he could have sold these, mm-hmm. and he'd have more exposure. His dealer, Sidney Janis, was really hot in the 50s, you know, one of the great dealers of abstract expressionism. Mm-hmm. And Sidney Janis put on the show The New Realists in 1962, sort of a groundbreaking international pop art show. But after that, you know, his influence as a dealer waned slowly and slowly and slowly. And Wesselmann was loyal and he stayed with Sidney Janis. And Leo Castelli took on two other pop artists. Mm-hmm. Warhol and Liechtenstein, and Leo Castelli went up. So with Leo, you know, Roy and Andy Warhol, you know, knew the fame that we know, and Wesselmann didn't have that major support from the major gallery. So he was a bit sidelined, although he sold a lot, you know. I mean, these things go for you know, figures in the 7 and 8. So. But he didn't have Castelli. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Warhol's just a different kind of artist, too.
Now, also it occurred to me, in terms of in the little bit of reading that I've done on him, he didn't like being classified as a pop artist.
Oh, he hated that, yeah.
So then, why are you classifying him as a pop artist?
No, we're saying beyond pop art.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's the reason of the title, because you can't deny his association with mm-hmm. pop. He was of all the major shows. He's in the top group, you know, with Rosenquist, Oldenburg, mm-hmm. Liechtenstein, mm-hmm. and Warhol. He's there, actually, in all the great shows. Mm-hmm. And he had, you know, great visibility in the pop moment. But pop was not an organized movement of any sort, and there was no manifesto, and these guys just happened to be the stars of a phenomenon that came to be known as pop art. But he was a formalist. He was making, you know, paintings. He was composing, you know, perfect paintings, and being labeled pop sort of distracted from that the stress he was putting on composition and on formal consideration and issues. Because when you say pop, you think, you know, brittle box, and you think object, and you think consumer and publicity. But that was just totally anecdotal in his work. He used that as a device, compositional element, material, but nothing more. He had nothing to say on consumer society. He didn't care. But of course, when you look at a painting like that, it's a still life, but he's just changing the oysters and the lobsters and the clams and the beautiful glass vases with what he saw around him. Mm-hmm.